You're traveling through another dimension. A dimension not only of luck and skill, but of mind. You're navigating on a river of tilt in an underworld of variance and risk. You've just crossed over into the mental game.
Hello and welcome to another episode of the Mental Game Radio Show. I am your host, Jared Tendler. I've got an interesting show today. I'm going to bring on three listeners to do some, call them mini sessions or longer Q&As, but we're going to talk about some issues, and it turns out my lineup is a bunch of Brits. So I've got three guys from the UK. We're going to bring them on, talk about tilt, talk about dealing with downswings, and also the fear, potentially some learning issues, inhibiting someone from breaking through and being able to take their game to another level. Before I get to bringing them on, I want to first talk about overconfidence. Last week, I had a fantastic interview with Gavin Griffin, and thankful for having him on. We talked mostly about overconfidence being at a very high level in the game. Overconfidence that comes with having a ton of success, having won poker's Triple Crown. And that's not evident for a lot of you. You may have had success in your own right, gotten complacent, stop learning, stop working on your game, and that ends up costing you. So there are other different kinds of issues that can emerge from overconfidence. There's also different types of overconfidence that can really damage your game in ways that I think many of you don't realize. I wrote a blog earlier this week entitled "Overconfidence is a Silent Killer," and that is really I think a great way of capturing overconfidence and what it really can do to your game, because it is such a silent issue, and silent because for most players they haven't realized that confidence can be a bad thing, that having too much confidence can lead to doing some pretty damaging things at the table. The assumption is have confidence, have as much as you possibly can. There can't be anything wrong with that. And the truth is there's a lot that can go wrong with it. There's a lot of different types of overconfidence. One comes from entitlement tilt. As I talk about in the book, this previously was more of a classic Phil Hellmuth tilt, because he basically treated people like and treated the game as though he deserved to win no matter how he played. You know, if he hadn't really adjusted to the games, it didn't really matter that he just assumed that no matter what, because of his experience, because of the fact that he'd won 11 World Series bracelets and was a dominant player for many years, that entitled him to win. I think this last year, he really showed something different at the World Series, and I think has definitely worked both on his game and also on his mental game. So that's probably one of the parts of the book that has become most out of date so far. But entitlement tilt is one. The illusion of learning is another, and this is a surprising one. I would call this like premature mastery, meaning that if you think you own something prematurely, when you get into stressful situations, your mind will actually shut down, and you'll make mistakes that you assumed you shouldn't make because you thought you'd mastered something. So what happens? Well, you end up getting pissed off, or you end up thinking less about your game. But in essence, you stop working on this area of your game because you thought it was mastered, which makes logical sense. You think something's mastered, it would be illogical for you to keep working on it. So the reality is that until you've proven skills to continually show up under pressure, you cannot assume that they're mastered, right? The illusion of learning is a powerful one. Believing that you can beat anybody. You know, oftentimes on a really good run, you can kind of get caught up in just believing that, you know, the good run is going to continue. And you can believe that you can beat anyone. The feeling is so real. But it's kind of like that line from Billy Madison, when Billy's getting on the bus and Chris Farley stops him and he says, "Veronica Vaughn, that piece of ace. Me and my, you know," and then he talks about how he hit that. "Well, no, you didn't. No, you didn't. Well, my buddy, I know he hit. No, you didn't." The point is, you can't beat anybody in the world. There are only a handful of players who can actually say that. So while it might feel like you can, you can't. And that's the illusion. So you have to realize that overconfidence in that situation can put you can get you playing in bigger games, can get you playing outside your bankroll, can get you playing against some pretty tough opponents unprepared. You know, when you're overconfident, generally it makes illogical sense to prepare as well as you would normally. And that's a big problem. So, there's one other that I want to talk about, and this, is one I specifically mentioned in the blog. And it basically kind of explains a lot of the overconfidence that occurs with fish and why they end up playing in games that they are obvious, losers in, but don't really know it. It's something that's been studied well, and actually has been given a pretty neat title. Neat, I just mean clean. It's called the Dunning-Kruger effect for the two people that studied this. The Dunning-Kruger effect basically says this. People who are so unskilled actually have an illusion of superiority because they mistakenly rate their ability to be much higher than average. And so this recognition is something that actually inhibits them from being able to recognize their own mistakes. So if you can imagine this, you're basically blind to your own weaknesses. And because you're blind, you have this illusion that your game is much better because you don't even realize how much you suck or in what ways that your game sucks. So it's a huge issue. This is why players get into some really bad games. But the thing is, I think for many of you, you fall into the same sort of trap at times. You forget that there are always weaknesses, that there are always areas of your game that you have to be improving. And if you forget that fact, then for that reason alone, you will start to fall, your game will start to slip. You know, so the reality is you've got to be always concerned and always paying attention to the reality that your game can slip if you don't realize that you have weaknesses. The other thing about this effect, the Dunning-Kruger effect, is that people who actually have skill, who actually have competence, their self-confidence, their confidence can actually be lower because they falsely assume others have the same skill level as them. So it's the same kind of flaw. Both are kind of imagining it is a little bit different, but the point is that these individuals are good players, but because they don't think that what they have is anything that's special or anything that unique, they actually lose confidence. And I think they also lose confidence because it can be easy once you've gained skill to realize how much more there is to learn. And so you sort of see this huge mountain to climb, not realizing how much of a mountain you've already climbed and how much farther up the mountain you actually are compared to others. And so you lose confidence as a consequence of that. So the take-home message here is overconfidence is a major issue. It's one that doesn't get talked about very often. And anybody who tells you different just doesn't understand the nature of confidence. Because the reality is, if your emotions are too positive, it will shut down your ability to think clearly in the exact same way that your brain will get shut down if you have tilt issues. You know, again, high emotion, whether it's positive emotion or negative emotion, has the same consequence on your brain as far as your thought process. Okay, so I'm going to bring on my first caller, Martin McConnell from the UK. Martin's got some questions about, so Zach, if we can get him on. Martin's got some questions about just breaking through his game. He studies a ton, has been working on his game a lot, and is unsure at this point if the issues are fear or some learning issues. So, Martin, are you there?
Hi there. How you doing, man?
Yeah, doing well. Thanks for coming on.
Yeah, no problem. Wasn't expecting this today. It's no surprise.
a good bit of variance, perhaps.
Yeah. But, I mean, it's an interesting kind of thing. I think it might help some other people as well. Yeah.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, that was certainly one of the reasons I wanted to have you on. I think there's a lot of people who study a ton and just haven't been able to break through. So.
Yeah, it's kind of strange. I mean, it's what made me think about this as well is we're in a world now where there's just so much training sites, so much ebooks, all the information is out there. So if someone's got loads of drive, do you actually really be successful in something? And all the resources are here. it's kind of there's this other thing which is kind of stopping them, and it's many other things which you talk about, more than one thing, I suppose. But yeah, it's kind of an interesting area.
Yeah, exactly. So talk to me a bit about kind of what you do to improve, what you've been doing, what you've been working on, and where you think you just you're stuck, basically.
I think a lot of it is probably getting bad skills to unconscious confidence by like just naturally making mistakes quite a lot. Overconfidence is a thing as well. But I mean, yeah, whenever I'm studying, I'll go the normal way. I'll read books, I'll watch training videos and podcasts, things like that are always very useful. I review hands. I've also had quite a bit of coaching over the last couple of years with a couple of players, which has been quite helpful. And that's probably had the biggest effect, I'd say.
Okay.
In terms of looking at things.
Yeah. So where do you think you're stuck?
I think part of it is, well, these are the issues which I've noticed in particular. One, you know, I find myself getting stuck in a rut when I'm playing, doing similar things. But I noticed last year one of the main things was actually getting just emotionally involved. Like often people get this when they're losing as well. They'll find themselves just making, just almost waiting to be beaten a lot of the time and things like that. And I'm definitely guilty of falling into those things where you're too emotionally involved in the game. Whenever you're reviewing hands away from the tables, you'll be a lot more logical. But when you're playing, as you've said, it clutters that mental space, I suppose.
Yeah, and I wonder if that gap, like being able to fill the gap between what you know off the table, what you're able to have access to at the table, whether or not you think that's a gap that can be overcome. I mean, what I mean by that is not that you can't learn what you currently know off the table and eventually bring it to the table, but more just the reality that gap even exists and that it will always exist and that it can't actually be removed. The details of what you're bringing off the table to the table, you know, will always change, and that will continue to evolve and grow. But that gap has to be there. There's no way to circumvent it. There's no way to overcome that exactly. I mean, when you're dealing with things off the table, your mind is much more free. You're able to think without any pressure. You're able
to
think without
rushed in the way you are when you're at the tables. Yeah,
exactly. There's no consequence for getting it wrong.
Yeah, it's very true. You can think much more logically and you're not drawn into the hand. Oftentimes when you're playing a hand and you're quite involved in other things as well, you never give it the full attention. You'll often think, oh, what am I going to do in this situation, you know, if he raises the turn? And then he folds and you don't have to consider that. Whereas if you're reviewing a hand away from the table, you'd be much more open to thinking, whereas you almost get away with not having to do that whenever you're playing.
Exactly. Yeah, and so I wonder if there's been a part of you that's been trying to not just fill that gap with your current knowledge, but fill that gap entirely. Like there's something wrong that you weren't able to have access to everything you knew when you were playing.
Well, I think something which I'm definitely guilty of and I've worked on is when people play too much tables, then naturally it's much harder to access all the information and think of things in the way you would if you were playing less tables. So I think that's definitely something to do with it. Thinking sort of negatively and thinking about other things whilst you're playing instead of focusing on the right decisions, I think is something else which could sort of block that and make it a little bit harder to sort of play well and make this gap bigger, I suppose.
Yeah, no doubt. Well,
bigger. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, you said it exactly. Like there's a limit to your sort of mental workload. Like how much can you think about and manage at any one particular point in time? When you're playing, you know, fewer tables, you have the ability to think about more things because you're not trying to leverage your knowledge base over more tables. You know, if you just keep adding tables and go, let's say, beyond your comfort level, you'll eventually get to the point where you're just purely autopiloting because you have to move so fast you can't actually think.
Or even worse, you know, you're just clicking buttons after a while because 10 decisions happen at once. And then this is something which I've noticed in the past as well, you know, when something like that happens, it's a cumulative tilt with something as well I wanted to make a note of, because I've kind of got over a lot of the emotional kind of issues of just thinking about the wrong things when I'm playing and sort of that kind of thing. But then, you know, you play well, you work on things, and then after a while a few things will happen, or, you know, maybe a week down the line you've had a bad week, a few hands, and then kind of, you know, you get quite tilted and then you come back again, and it's kind of rinse and repeat. You want to make them as far away as possible from each other, but that's another issue which I've noticed in terms of actually stopping yourself from moving forward and actually getting the sort of win rate and moving up the stakes that we all aspire to, really.
Sure. And then how does that affect you off the tables?
Well, generally, this is the thing. I'm like a really calm person normally away from the tables. I always have been. But poker's one of the only things which really sort of riles me up sometimes. But at the same time, you know, I love the game. I'd love to play professionally one day, and I'm still sort of working towards that. But it's strange. It's, yeah.
Let me ask you this. Do you think that in poker you've invested your time, energy, and even yourself in a way that you haven't with anything else?
Sorry, let me get rid of that. Say that again, sorry?
Do you think that you've invested yourself, just time, energy, and just your own emotions about how you feel personally in poker more than you have anything else?
Definitely in the last 3 or 4 years, definitely.
Okay.
I mean, between my sort of was obsessed with music for a while and learned that, and there's a university as well. But poker, it's always been something which I've always sort of made contact with every day, and it's always been sort of an interest and something which I've really worked with. So yeah, it's always kind of, I've invested a lot of time and emotion in it, but still, it feels like I'm not a quitter. Kind of, I just want to keep going until it, you know, when it hurts, keep going because you're getting towards the end, kind of thing, you know?
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Well, and I think just the fact that you've invested so much can actually put more pressure on it. You know, like you want it more, and so because of that, what'll end up happening is, yeah, you're calm off the table and generally in other things in life, but poker, because of that pressure, because you want it more. It digs out more of some of these underlying issues. The intensity is greater. Intensity essentially causes weaknesses to show up. Like weaknesses definitely. Emerge under that kind of pressure.
But it is pressure, yeah, because, I mean, it's one thing you sit on and you really feel like you've got to play. And it's good to be. I remember it was Hasib Qureshi a while back done something which talked about mistakes and how you should really beat yourself up over mistakes. Because,
yeah, I just,
and this is something you naturally do once you start building things, because it allows you to, it's the carrot and the stick, I suppose. But yeah, you can use it in your favor, or you can use it to kind of be scared and not play, which is something else I do sometimes as well when I'm losing.
Yeah, I think that's really, really not harmful advice. I think there are some people out there who that will benefit, but I think in the long run, that way of thinking is short-sighted. It becomes a little of the beaten dog syndrome.
Okay.
And what can end up happening is that you end up becoming fearful of mistakes because you beat the crap out of yourself. Or you start to hesitate while you're playing because you don't want to make mistakes.
Yeah, you're kind of scared of the outcome of
exactly.
You know what. How are you going to feel afterwards?
And then three, because you're so pissed off, it actually clouds your thinking. It makes it harder for you to learn. So while it
That's
might sort
good,
of spark your motivation, you know, your motivation to learn, it may not actually stick. And that's a problem. So to me, I'm not saying be happy about mistakes. I'm not saying like celebrate them. Although in some certain situations you might. But what I'm saying is recognize mistakes. Take aggressive action to fix them. But realize that as long as you're learning, if you're not making mistakes, you're not working hard enough. You're not putting yourself in situations where your game sort of where you get to identify where your limitations are. And the other thing is be organized about them. You're going to continue to make the same or similar mistakes for a long period of time. And until you've solved that particular issue, be prepared every single time you play to make that correction. And until you've mastered it, proven that you can correct it consistently under pressure, unconscious competence, then you've got to keep working. Otherwise, it becomes more and more likely for it to show up.
So, yeah, it's a case of just really staying calm and focused and just being very conscious of the whole process, I suppose, and sort of viewing whenever you do find yourself getting rationalizing situations and sort of mistakes, kind of thing. Yeah, I'm doing this wrong. This is a mistake. I know I should be doing it. And then, yeah, sort of working through it methodically and making that a process which you are willing to do every time you play.
Exactly, exactly. Yeah. You know, and there's one concept that is not in my current book, might be in the next one. Actually, well, if I do a next one, it definitely will be. It's called the transfer of context.
Okay.
And this touches upon what we were alluding to earlier about this gap that exists between what you can do off the table and then what you can do at the table. So this transfer of context means that you're trying to take a piece of knowledge and move it through situations that vary in degree of intensity and pressure. So when you're off the table, you're calm, you're talking with some friends, and it's really light, easy conversation, mm-hmm. you have access to more of that entirety of this of your skill set, more knowledge in the process of being learned because mm-hmm. because of that state of mind. Okay, so then as you get into situations where the pressure increases, so let's say you're playing, you know, four tables, and that's like a warm-up for you. Okay, mm-hmm. so that's like, you know, level two. So level one's off the table, level two is four tables or even two tables. Okay. Level two or level three here now is playing six tables or seven tables, which for you is average. I'm just making that up. So whatever it is for mm-hmm. you or others listening.
Yeah.
Then level four is playing those same number of tables but while running bad. And then level five is playing those same number of tables while running bad and you playing in some bigger games with more money.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, you can think of level six. But the point is that as you move through these different stages...
Stacking all of these different things to make things more difficult, essentially.
Exactly. And so then in each situation, as you go from level one to level two and level two to level three and level three to level four, your skill set decreases. You have less... you have access to less knowledge because of the pressure. Because the pressure... Even if you're not feeling anxious, I'm not even saying anxious, I'm just saying the intensity of what's going on.
Yeah.
You have access to less and less information.
Yeah, and you're making more decisions. You've got less time to focus on each individual table, each individual decision, and as a result, yeah. And also, for an average player, the skill advantage would become even smaller as you get higher up on those levels as well.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Now, I'm not saying that you can't... you know, be able to have access to it unconsciously, like be in the zone,
mm-hmm.
but you can't get there consciously. You don't have enough brain space. But what'll end up happening is if you're playing like truly kind of out of your mind, you're just so locked in and zoned in,
mm-hmm.
oftentimes you will gain access to that larger skill set that you can have access to off the tables. And you can play at an even higher level than you could have imagined before, but you can't do it consciously. There's a reservoir. There's like an undercurrent of knowledge that is just sort of intuitive.
So, in order to kind of pull these closer, would this be a case of, as you talk about in your book, moving from getting more and more things to the level of unconscious competence?
Exactly.
So then naturally you'll be able to draw on those things a lot easier than you would have done.
That's right. That's right. If your range is too wide. If your variance, like the gap between your A game and your C game is too wide, you have too much to think about consciously to even have the ability to access some of more of that intuitive unconscious stuff.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense.
Okay. Yeah. So you've got to chop off the back end of your range. You've got to be eliminating C game as your...
That's what they always said about Chip Reese, wasn't it? I think I watched something with Dor Brunson the other day. It was the Bad Beat for Cancer series. He'd done a video and he was like, what made Chip Reese so good? And he said, well... In his own words, he said, my A game isn't much better than everyone else, but my C game is like right behind it, you know.
Yeah, that is 100% accurate. And it's true just about in every sport. I mean, just to give you a golf example, Tiger Woods, let's say a few years ago, obviously he's played like an ass recently. Mm-hmm. But Tiger Woods, let's say 3 years ago, compared to Phil Mickelson, you know, they were 1-2 in the world.
Yeah.
The difference between Tiger at his worst might actually have been three shots better than Mickelson when Mickelson was at his worst. Tiger didn't miss cuts. Mickelson missed cuts. Tiger hung around, made a cut, was able to play the last two rounds, and he won some tournaments because of it. And at a minimum, he was able to recover and rebound in the midst of good rounds where he was in the lead, easier because he had that skill. He had the ability to recover better. But the two of them at their best, I mean, you know, it's like a coin
tough. Tough call, yeah. Exactly.
Tough way to go. So
same with Pokemon. Once you get right to the top, the edges are so thin.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. So is this helping?
Yeah, no, I mean, it's interesting as well. I'm often with these things, I'll be talking, and then I'll get it all when I come back and listen to it again later. But yeah, no, it's cool because I think it is that big gap between theory and play, I think, is one of the main things, isn't it? Just actually getting more to the level of unconscious competence with certain things. And so you're actually, improving at the table. Because away from the table, we have the time to sort of improve and make correct decisions. But when we're playing, often there's other things stopping us in terms of thinking too much about certain things, playing too much tables and getting to a higher level in that way, as you just spoke about.
Right.
So, yeah.
In your message before, you mentioned there might have been some fear in here. I mean, do you think that the fear really wasn't necessarily fear, but it was more just a question of just better understanding the context, and that there was just pressure involved, and that maybe over time it may have appeared to be fear because you weren't performing quite as well?
I think definitely pressure is a big thing as well. Because like when you put yourself pressure on yourself to be good and for results to come and for all of these other things and expecting to see results coming quite soon, I suppose I didn't really think how much pressure I was actually putting myself on in those situations. Because, I mean, there is the fear as well, but it's not so much fear. Fear is just an easy way of sort of describing something sometimes. A reason when you want to play, but, like, you're not quite sure. You kind of feel like, you know, when people are running bad, for example, you don't really want to put yourself in that situation as much because it's like touching the stove. You know it's bad to kind of, you know, so you would avoid pleasure pain kind of thing.
Exactly.
Yeah, but I think, perhaps if I think more about pressure, that would make sense, and taking that pressure off a little bit.
Well, but remember, we're just trying to remove a little bit of it. It's like turning down the dial on the intensity scale. It's not about, you don't want to take it completely off the stove, because then you won't be able to get in the zone. You won't be able to play at your peak. I mean, that's another lesson from the book, which is, you know, the performance stress curve, where there's this relationship between, you know, stress level, intensity, emotional level, and performance. And, you know, I've talked about it a lot with regards to tilt. Certainly fear is part of it. But when your emotions are too hot, your brain shuts down, you can't think as clearly, you perform poorly. But when you don't have enough energy, if you're tired, you're on autopilot, you're bored, you know, you don't have enough energy to think clearly. And so you'll perform sort of equally bad at that point because you don't have enough energy to so when you're working on this, try to like calibrate that intensity. See if you can and understand how to balance yourself at the top of that curve so you can better manage the stress, you know, without getting your energy level too low, and without, you know, getting your energy too hot.
Yeah, no, I think that makes a lot of sense because you can get quite excited whenever you're in high-pressure situations, like, you know, getting to a final table or something. The pressure is really on, but you thrive on it in that situation.
Exactly.
Whereas the pressure for results or something like that, it's harder to actually achieve. It's something which you can't, it's variant, so you won't necessarily be able to achieve it that way. But the pressure is still there, and it's forcing you to maybe do things differently, which you wouldn't have done. So it's using pressure to your advantage and balancing that intensity, as you say. Yeah,
exactly. That's exactly right.
It's quite interesting, quite good stuff.
Well, and
so let me ask you this, I mean, the listeners as well.
Yeah, exactly. Well, I hope so. So let me ask you this: do you think that, just in the other players that you've talked to, that this issue of just understanding the difference in context and understanding the effect of pressure is common?
It would make sense. But, I mean, this is something which I haven't really talked to a huge amount of people about it. Because, I mean, I play a lot online. There's a group of guys who I play with quite a bit live. But, I mean, generally, like my coaching in the past is normally just sort of about card strategy and stuff like that, and betting strategy. It's not so much about mental game stuff. But it does make sense. I mean, and just reading around the subject, that it is a common thing, I'd have thought.
Yeah, I think so. I just wanted to get your opinion. I mean, it's
yeah, no, I could definitely
to me, I think. Yeah, I was just going to say, to me, it's just one of those things where if you don't understand the nature of the environment that you're competing in, and I don't mean poker here, I just mean the nature of the mental environment. That's where your skill is sort of being displayed. Mm. If you don't understand that, the nature of that, then you're sort of, you know, a little behind as far as being able to understand what is occurring. I mean, there's so many unknowns in poker. But the unknowns in your own mind about what you're trying to deal with to perform at a high level is also quite high. So there's a premium placed on just better understanding the learning process. Mm-hmm. And if you're stuck, there is premium placed on figuring out how to get yourself unstuck. Because most likely what's going to happen, at some point down the road, you're going to get stuck again. It happens to everybody. It's just the nature of improvement. Unless you're learning from somebody else constantly,
yeah,
you're going to go through setbacks.
I think, yeah, definitely. And so about being in the right environment sort of mentally. I mean, two of the best sort of things I thought in the book, one was the process model, which comparing what I said about earlier about how everyone's got the resources now, that if someone has the drive, using something like that, it takes things down to a nice simple level where people can actually, you know, preparation, performance, results, evaluation, analysis. You can just move through that process, gradually improving. Exactly. And the other thing was the conscious incompetence and how your mind gets foggy because you can only think of so much. You've only got so much mental energy. They were two of the things in particular which really sort of stuck out because, yeah, they're just really well, clearly sort of described. Something quite simple, but at the same time, very complex as well. And when you actually think about applying that to things.
Yeah, it is. It's so true. The limitations of the mind are unknown to a lot of people. And I'm glad that you thought that, you know, they were fairly clearly laid out. And I just want to be clear to those listening who haven't read the book. The adult learning model is not something I made up. The concept of interim, I made up. But the process model is more of an observation as far as, the sort of the stages that people go through in their performance. But, you know, the limitations of the mind, as you're talking about, working memory, like the place where you're actually having thought, is limited. You only have so much to be able to think about. And if you're under pressure, that amount shrinks because the emotional system is becoming overactive. So the goal really is to try to be maximizing the space that you have. It's kind of like your muscles. You're trying to maximize the output of your muscle. In this case, you're trying to maximize the output of your mind. And being able to do that means that you even understand what the limitations are. What is this thing that you're working within? And I think for the most part, a lot of people, they aren't willing to really learn about it. And I'm not saying that you've got to, you know, get a master's degree and a PhD in this, but you have to recognize that the mental game and understanding learning are key factors to being able to be at your best.
Most definitely, yeah. I mean, it's a great book. I've only read it through once now, and I keep coming back to it again. So anyone listening who doesn't have it, go buy it. I'll say save a little ad for you. Because, yeah, that's fantastic. I mean, I'm a huge fan of Tommy Angelo as well, and he does quite a different thing, and they complement each other really well, I think. And I've only listened to the first half of your show with him last week. I'm looking forward to listening to that again later on as well, because... I was never sure whether you two were mates or whether it was a rivalry there. I don't know.
Well, I think when I was first coming onto the scene as like any, you know, young upstart, I mean, I was probably more competitive than he was. I mean, he's not of that nature, but I've come to have a much more deep respect for his for what he offers, and I'm glad you see it as that we do compliment it, because I think that's how he and I see it as well. That we come from very different perspectives. I mean, he's a poker player. I'm not, for one. So that being very different, but also that our perspectives do overlap enough where you can get sort of the same information from a different perspective. And sometimes what he'll say will resonate more with somebody else. Sometimes what I'll say will resonate more with them. So it to me, like I'm motivated by helping people to play better. I mean, I make money. You make money. That's my that's my deal. So, whether that is because I'm pointing you in the direction to talk to Tommy, or whether that's because of things that are coming straight out of my mouth. Ultimately the more people who are successful, the more people who are working at this and improving, the better it is. So yeah, I appreciate the plug.
Yeah, and no, it's good because it's. It's really cool because there's not really that much places which actually have this amount of information sort of together. Because I mean, Elements of Poker was written many years ago as well, and it's quite sure it's very different in terms of the mental game book because they cover quite different things. One's quite abstract and one's much more scientific as well. They really complement each other. Definitely.
Excellent. Well, thanks for the compliments. All right, Martin. Well thanks for coming on in, and really interesting conversation. And,
yeah, definitely, man. Hope everyone got something out of it.
Yeah, and agreed.
Thank you very much for doing this as well. And hopefully I'll be in contact with you at some point as well, where once I start moving up the levels.
There you go.
Excellent. Thanks a lot, mate. Thanks a lot. And,
you're welcome.
Have a good evening. Cheers.
All right, cool. All right. Well, thanks, Martin. We're going to take a quick break, and we're going to get Russ on soon after. And we are back after that short little break. Apparently my UK brethren are a little screwed up with time change. US had a time change a couple weeks ago, and we're actually only 4 hours from the East Coast over to the UK, so I think they thought we were coming on a little later for them. So while we hang around here a little bit to see if a couple other guys are going to come on, I can answer some questions. If anybody in the QuadJacks forum wants to come on, you guys are welcome to throw QJ calls into your Skype, and we'll bring you on. Otherwise, I want to talk a little bit more about some of the things that Martin and I were just talking about. Some of the learning issues that emerge for poker players for a variety of reasons that they just aren't really aware of. I mentioned this transfer of context. That's a huge one. Another way to sort of think about that transfer is to imagine that you have a mini adult learning model, a mini four stages or four steps that exists within each of those levels. So what you'll see is away from the table, you'll have much more access to your skill set. So you might be consciously competent or even unconsciously competent about certain areas of your game. But as you get to level three, you're actually consciously incompetent about those things. So they're only going to show up when you're playing at a pretty high level. But if you're slightly tilted or slightly off, that's the stuff that goes away. So what it ends up doing is if you can imagine your bell curve or your inchworm or the range of your game, right, A to C game, being placed vertically, then what you can see is that as you move from those different contexts, so from stage one or level one, where there's no pressure, you're off the table, things are easy, into stage two and into stage three, your skill set begins to compress. And so some of the conscious competent stuff becomes harder to remember. Some of the things you thought were unconsciously competent, you actually now have to think about. And so your skill set gets a little bit more compacted and starts to dip down. Now, what you can see across these different contexts, if you're really good and you want to spend some time and actually working at this, what you do is you develop a different range, A to C game, right? Assessment of your game while you're away from the table, so you have an understanding of what you can do really well when talking with friends, talking with buddies, or in posting in forums. And so you have your range there. And then when you get to level 2, 3, 4, 5, or 6, you have a different assessment at those levels. So what ends up happening is you get to actually see the progression of your these skills as they move through the different contexts. And it does take some work to do this. It's not standard, believe me. There's not a lot of people who are thinking in these terms, which means that there's a lot of edge and a lot of value to being able to do it. But the point is that if you can identify that when you're at like level 3 stress level or level 5 stress level, you know, that a certain aspect of your game disappears, then you're able to realize that it's probably kind of next on deck. That's the thing that you want to be focused on next, because learning poker is very much like learning or like progressing through the stages of the different belts in karate. There is a progression that can occur. And if you see that progression in your own game, then you're not going to rely solely on videos or poker coaches to tell you what you need to learn next. You can actually do so by analyzing your own progression of your own skill set. It's a bit complex, but one that is certainly valuable if you put the time in to do it. Okay, well, looks like Russ is ready to go, one of my UK friends here. So let's get him on the line, Zach, and see what we can do. If I recall, Russ was struggling with some tilt issues earlier today, so this may be very, very good timing to have him come on the show. Russ, are you there?
Oh, I am, Jared, yeah.
Hey, thanks for coming on, man.
No problem. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, absolutely. So what specifically are you in need of some help with today?
Well, I'm struggling to adjust my game back into a decent way of playing. Recently, you know, I've gone from playing low-stakes poker to trying to create more of a game for myself rather than just playing in a certain way. I say I've come from a pub poker background, and you have to approach the game differently. I've really struggled to get into playing a proper game of poker since that point. and it's getting me down because there's certain things around me and in life that, you know, just drag you down as well as that. And that, dealing with that as well, it's just, it's not part of my psyche.
Yeah, so what specifically is happening? Like, if you can give some examples of where that transition is really breaking down.
Well, I've come from a point where playing pub poker and winning in pub poker.
Okay.
It's a low stakes thing. It's fun. It's friendly. It's in a pub. It's not taken too seriously, and trying to take a step up to a higher level is quite a thing. Approaching it, I'm trying to learn whilst trying to win still, if you right. see what I mean. So it's going in two different ways.
Right. So does that mean that when you make mistakes at the table, that they piss you off more, that they're sort of harder to deal with?
Yeah, I tend to get a bit unruly.
is that putting it
lightly? I make a lot of mistakes because I see people sucking out on me.
Okay.
With the same hands that I'm trying to play to suck out on them, but it's difficult.
Yeah, it's like you're trying to fight back to win, but doing so in a way that actually makes you more out of control and makes you like them.
And most of the time, I'm valuing them in by doing so, and that's where I come unstuck.
Right, right. Okay, so do you think that there's an underlying motive for you to try to win at the same rate that you were winning at in the pub games?
Yes and no. I mean, it's from a lifestyle point of view, just to make a few bucks would be great. Coming from where I am at the moment, I'm not doing a lot other than trying to make a few bucks, if you see what I mean.
Uh-huh.
I'm trying to take it too seriously by throwing myself in there. I've thought about it over the last couple of days, actually, where I took a ridiculous beat on Monday, and that's where I snapped. And I've snapped to a point where I've only been playing decent, and I've been playing the odd rubbish hand like I was, and telling myself, no, you shouldn't be doing that. And, you know, it was working. And then one thing leads to another, I fall apart again. And I'm back to stage one. I just can't get that edge. I need to find that one win where it all changed. You know, my positive thinking would be plus EV for me, if you see what I mean.
I do, and I think part of the problem is that you think one win will change everything.
Yeah, it did do before. It did do before. I mean, it gets okay. me off that out of that feeling. It wasn't a win. I came second out of several thousand, and it wasn't a big buy. It was only a $1 sketchy tournament on Black Belt Poker, and that was that. I was happy as Larry, and I went for 6 months without a problem. And then one blip, one hand, I could even put it down to, and it all goes wrong again. It's really strange. It's just having not read your book either, that doesn't help.
Well, I certainly can pull out a few things from the book that will help you in the meantime before you pick it up. Well, sometimes when that first thing goes wrong, it almost becomes like license to say, fuck it.
Mm.
You know, and like everything that you're trying to build is getting crushed. And I think you've got to really see the value in fighting, see the value in like developing what I would call like the skill of resiliency. When things get hard, you sort of kind of bear down and make sure that there becomes like a stop loss in how bad your game can get. Mm. See, one of the things that is true as far as the training of tactical or mental skill is that when you are under significant pressure, which is what occurs, you know, at that moment when something goes wrong and you have the potential to just say fuck it and let your entire game go to hell. If at that time you can play, let's say, a solid B game and avoid some of these major mistakes, there is a massive, massive, massive training effect for being able to get that like basic skill, the C game kinds of stuff, trained to the level where it becomes automatic. And then now you've created a true sort of stop loss for your game. And once it's trained to the level where it's automatic, which is called unconscious competence, then you do it no matter how tilted you are. This stuff is no longer part of your range.
Yeah, you can believe in that you feel what you're doing is right.
Yeah, you believe it, but also from just a pure skill set. Like an example of unconscious competence is driving, right?
Right.
You get into the car and you drive to the pub and you know exactly what you're doing. You don't have to think about all the specifics about how to drive. You know, maybe there's something unique about that day. Somebody jumps in front of you and you have to react to it. But your reaction isn't a thought. You're reacting because you already have this huge amount of skill about how to drive. And you react in the moment instantaneously.
It becomes instinct. Save yourself in it.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So when you train certain aspects of your poker skill to that level, it's the same deal. You instantly know what to do. You instantly fold a hand. You instantly, don't shove over somebody who's been running over you. The knowledge is there automatically. And right now, it's not. But if you fight for it, at the times where it's really tough, and you're able to consistently train proper decision-making, proper thinking, both mentally and tactically, there's a huge training effect that occurs, and you actually speed up the learning process by doing that. And I do realize that this is hard. I'm not saying that this is easy, but the value is there. And so I'm saying all this because I'm trying to motivate you to do a couple...
Yeah, well, the aptitude to learn is there. I mean, I've previously worked for American Airlines as a security, and the what they put us through there in the learning curve and the way they were teaching me, it was great. It really applies to a lot of things in poker as well.
Very cool.
Like it's screening. It's thinking outside the box all the time. And I adapted to that so well, and I learned so well. I got to a point where I was at Gatwick Airport in England, and it was. I got to a point where they couldn't give me any more work to do. And I'm trying to apply that sort of method of way of thinking to learn. But at the same time, I'm thinking, well, something is going wrong here because maybe I'm not adjusted to it. And that's what's pulling me back, is my ability to learn. Why am I not learning here? That's actually what is tilting me.
Well, but I think you may be underestimating one big factor. With American Airlines, I mean, they had a protocol. They had a way of teaching. They had people who were helping you. You gained real world experience. You got immediate feedback. The training environment was intense, and you had people there supporting you through that entire process. In poker, you do also, but not nearly to the same degree, and certainly not nearly to the same level of organization. And that's a huge difference.
Right.
Okay. So now you're dealing with poker where there's a hell of a lot of unknowns. And then that outer layer of what the hell to learn and how to learn and how to go about doing that becomes an extra layer of uncertainty, which actually makes performing harder. Because now not only are you trying to figure out the unknowns of the table and make proper decisions, but you're also even wondering whether or not the way you're thinking is even right to begin with.
Mm-hmm. Well, the end of the day, I've found that what I've had in the way of learning that's been offered to me has been great, but some of it didn't actually apply to me because it was either above my level or way above my level, therefore useless, and it's confused me.
Yes.
And then getting back on track to a point where I should be learning a few more basics in the C game, where I'm actually getting A mixed with B game thrown at me.
Yes.
It's why it's confusing me a bit more.
Well, and I'm glad that you were able to recognize that. There's definitely a lot of people who don't, and they try to outlevel themselves in a sense. So here's what I suggest you do. Really work hard to really understand the mistakes that you make when you're tilted, whenever you're playing poorly at the tables. Any mistake that you make at that time is currently within your range, meaning that it's your C game. It's the reality of your C game. And for better or for worse, it's reality. In some respects, I don't really care how you think about it, because it's reality. So you can either deny that reality or you can accept it and deal with it. Everything that doesn't show up, like the mistakes that you might have made in the past that you no longer are making, you've mastered them. So the point is that there are certain elements of the game that you don't make, the certain mistakes that you don't make anymore. But there are still a lot of mistakes that you are still making. So there has to be a priority placed on improving those every single time you play. Every single time you play, your job is to make sure that your C game does not show up. So you create a document, a sheet that lists out, these common mistakes. You have worked out the corrections to them. You've got some hands in mind that will help you to remember, like how you made the mistake in the past and then how you've played correctly. So as you're preparing before a session, you're reviewing these, and maybe there's even just a note card or something on your phone that's really quickly to reference.
You wouldn't believe it. I've already done that. I was given by Jamie Berland a hand range sheet on PDF, and I saved it as a background to my screen. So all I have to do is literally, it is my desktop is the hand ranges for playing six max cash. I drop the table and bang, it's there, and I can put it back up again if I have to have it.
Okay.
You know, it's just a simple thing like that, and I found that's really helped. But at the same time, when it has helped, I'm going by that, and then I find myself getting sucked out again. It's not worked, you know. And I even tried to use Holder Manager as well to give me a bit, and that really has confused me.
Well,
that's supposed to be an aid, you see.
The problem, and for those, your audio is getting a little fuzzy. So for those of you who didn't hear all that, basically you've got something there to help you with that, but it kind of goes to hell when you get sucked out on and you get tilted. The problem is that you're waiting too long to begin working at it. So the point is that when your emotions rise too high, you lose access to normal thinking. Your mind actually begins to malfunction, and that's just a reality of the brain. So the emotional system has the power to shut down higher brain function, which means you can have that in the background, but unless you're really invested in understanding why it is so important for you to fight to make those plays, then it becomes a lot easier to sort of make the choice in that moment to say fuck it and let your game go off the cliff. So there's two things. One is I think you've got to really be clear about your motivation, that your motivation has to be to eliminate C game. And that gets a hell of a lot easier when you're under significant pressure and you fight to be able to regain a solid mindset. The second part of that is that if you're getting pissed off when you're getting sucked out on, the mental side of that poker mistake is a big issue. So you've got to work on it. There may be injustice tilt or running bad tilt or hate losing tilt associated with that, which it's kind of beyond the scope of our conversation today, but you've got to try to identify the reasons for why you're getting so pissed off at the table.
I can identify that straight away. I steam more than a train, a kettle,
Yeah.
That's the only way to describe it. One hand, I've just played a game tonight, and I've had pocket eights. It's gone all the way down to the river. The guy's checked, called me all the way down, and he's hit his queen on the river. That was that. After that, the next time I picked up a half decent hand, I'm thinking, well, I've not got the stack I had. I should be playing this a bit more aggressively. And the next thing you know, I'm banging ace 10 into aces, and it hurt.
Yeah,
I can recognize where I'm steaming, but can I do anything about it? Yeah, I can, but it's just that one. I'll always refer back to it whilst I'm trying to come off of it. So it's just too.
Okay, so that's the trigger, that's the situation that pisses you off, but the question is why.
Yeah, I can't understand. It's someone else's. I never will understand someone else's want to play, to stick chips into a pot where they're not going to, But to understand my own sort of play, I do the same thing. So I find it very difficult to understand what I'm doing as to what they're doing right.
So you're pissed that you're making the same mistakes as they do.
Yeah, but they always seem to benefit from it.
Okay, so there's a bit of injustice.
Yeah, more marginally, I'd say.
Okay, so we've got injustice, but again, it's still a little bit fuzzy. What I would suggest doing is doing some pretty detailed writing after these sessions, or even immediately after those hands, where you get out of your head on paper, even just in quick note form, about what you're steaming about. There's always going to be an underlying reason for it. Even though you can't logically explain why you're steaming so much, there is an underlying reason for it. And that reason has to be broken down. The flawed logic attached to it has to be found so that you can correct it. Once you correct it, that same trigger can happen. But your reaction is very different.
It's like venting it afterwards. I am known to stick a screenshot on Facebook, for example, or post some text. Why did someone do that on a forum? And I'll get it thrown back at me. You know, I'm approaching other people for help, but they'll see it as more of a hindrance. That's really creating more negativity for me to think, well, I'm actually doing something wrong here. I've got to deal with it, but it's not getting dealt with because it's a negative thing. But I'll try and turn that into a positive thing.
I understand. So people aren't responding to you in the way that you were hoping.
Yeah.
Your intent is being a little muddled.
Yeah. I'd rather see myself being able to learn something from it by someone else pointing out something good straight away rather than saying, you just played it bad. But why did I play it bad? There's not much logic out there, unfortunately. People would have the way they play it, and they'll tell you that it was played bad. But I don't get why I played it bad. So it's not very productive.
Yeah. Okay, so we just kind of rewind here. I think the strategy has to be venting off the table to understand this for yourself. Mm-hmm. You know, keep trying to find people who will help you. I wouldn't give up on that. But just realize that just because you haven't gotten help in the short term doesn't mean that that the help isn't available or won't come. You just haven't found the right people yet. Two, beforehand, not just review those mistakes as you've been doing, but commit yourself to making sure that you correct them when things begin to go wrong. So I realize that you're talking about, you know, the steam can come straight away. But there may be some subtle signs that occur earlier where your mind may begin to get compromised. So you take a few deep breaths, slow yourself down just enough so you can think clearly, and then you inject the logic that says, I have to fight to fix my C game. If I do, it's going to have a huge effect on my game long term, and I'm going to make, you know, progress very rapidly, and eventually you'll get to the point where some of the material that was too advanced for you, you'll be able to begin taking on, because essentially you're limited to how good your A game can become by how weak your C game actually is.
Yeah. It's a foundation, isn't it?
Exactly. The foundation allows you to take you higher. It's building a solid
structure to my game on a good foundation.
Exactly. Exactly. All right, Russ, is that helpful?
That's really helpful. I'm going to toddle along and buy your book out of the Black Belt Poker Store right now, actually, off my points. Perfect. It might come to fruition from that.
I appreciate that plug. I'm sure the Black Belt Poker guys are happy about that, too.
it's there for the taking. I've earned it through rake, so and at the end of the day, that's what they're offering me, and I'll take it.
Exactly.
Neil will be happy to know that as well.
Exactly, and Snippy as well. Those are good guys over there.
Yeah, they've got a great training system, so
agreed.
Just need to take advantage of it a bit better. Thanks, Jared.
All right, yeah, you're welcome. All right, well, let's one sec here. Russ, good talking to you, and wish you well. I just want to see if we have enough time. Looks like we have my third guy here coming in late. All right, yeah, we do have time. So, Zach, let's get Tom on. Now, Tom was mentioning that he was having some trouble dealing with some downswing. Some downswings and some frustration with it. So, all right, we're just getting some feedback from Tom. So, just kind of wrapping up stuff with Russ there. I think it's really another important point. It's kind of ironic that the questions so far have really kind of dealt with learning. Being able to consistently perform under pressure and allows you to train skills at a higher rate than you would normally. And that's just a reality. So in order to do that takes preparation, takes organization. If you aren't organized, you aren't prepared, all of that gets harder. And it's just a fact. The reality is that, learning to play at higher and higher levels, gets easier when your C game is a lot stronger, when your range is a lot narrower. And, a lot of poker players focus on improvement. Only from their A game. They watch a ton of videos. They're posting hands in forums and, you know, are just not really focused on not really focused on exactly what they need to be doing to improve their C game. It's just about more of the fun stuff, more of the exciting stuff, which is all, you know, the new nuggets from a new video or a new article or something they read on a forum. They want to go test it out like it's a hot new car. But, you know, in the short term, that's a short-sighted way of looking at improvement. You're going to increase your own variance, increase the degree to which your game can vary on a day-to-day basis. And when you're good, you're really good. But when you're off, it's going to be pretty bad and pretty disgusting. And that's the way to deal with it. So, all right, looks like we've got Tom ready, and let's bring him on. Hey, Tom, are you there?
Yeah, how's it going?
Yeah, it's going well, man. How are you?
Not bad at all, not bad.
Excellent. Well, glad we were able to squeeze you in on the end here. I'm assuming we had some trouble with the time changes and whatnot. So what are some of the issues that you're looking to solve today? Is it dealing with some downswings and frustration associated with that?
Yeah, I've been on a pretty big downswing, the biggest downswing I've ever had for about the last 4.5 weeks.
Okay.
And I don't know, just losing a bit of confidence, and every time I play, I feel as if I get really frustrated really quickly about really small things that wouldn't normally bother me.
Right.
I've written a few things down. I feel as if I'm always chasing a big loss every time I play, and I'm just looking for that one God mode session to kind of turn everything around. Rather than just, you know, trying to make good decisions, and just feels as if I get frustrated really, really quickly.
Okay. Well, just talking about the frustration and how quick it's happening now. In essence, what that is accumulated tilt or accumulated emotion. The best way I can describe it is if emotion was a glass of water, and every day, you know, let's say at the beginning of this downswing, every day your glass filled up with a little bit of water. You went to sleep, you had some fun, maybe had a pint, and you know that water was chucked out. Show up the next day, cup is empty, fills up a little bit, same deal. The end of the day, it gets chucked out. But then as the bad run wears on, the emotion begins to linger. So you try to chuck all that water out, you come back the next day, and there's a little bit still kind of hanging around, lingering around, and that makes it easier for you to tilt because it doesn't take as much to tilt you. So then at the end of the day, so then during that session, more emotion, more water fills up in your glass. You chuck it out, but now more is now lingering on before the next day before you play, and that pattern just repeats and repeats and repeats until you find yourself where you're at now, which is tilting very rapidly because you've got this accumulated emotion in your head. Does that essentially describe what's going on?
Yeah, definitely.
Okay, so there's a few ways to look at resolving or kind of chucking some of this accumulated tilt. One is to take a break. You know, downswings are hard. There's no doubt about it. And when you're tired and your mind is sort of drained from fighting to try to play well and to get back on track, you're actually in a mentally weaker position, which makes the amount of emotion that it takes to overcome your mind even less. So it takes less emotion just for the fact that you're just not as strong. It's like the equivalent if you were, you know, doing something pretty physically intense for many days, weeks, and months at a time, and you were just burnt out from fighting for so long. You know, your body's breaking down, you're tired. So taking a few days off is actually a good thing. But before Sure. you do that, what we can use, though, is that essentially the emotion is accumulating for the same reason. You know, the pattern of which you tilt is kind of embedded in this accumulated tilt. So do you have a sense as to like what are the specific things that cause you to tilt and then eventually cause the accumulation of a lot of that stuff to occur?
I mean, I would definitely blame it most on me making bad decisions rather than something else that I can't control. Definitely when I do something stupid, it just makes me it just makes me even more annoyed at myself because I know that I'm not helping things.
Right, right. Like self-inflicted wounds.
Yeah, totally. I mean, sometimes it just gets to the point where I know that I'm doing something wrong, but I'll just say, you know, stuff that I'm doing it anyway and just click call or go all in or just do something like, you know, do something stupid that I know that I don't think it's the best decision, but I'm doing it anyway.
Right. Let me ask this. Stepping aside from the specific tactical mistakes that you're making, just on a pure mental side.
Okay, sure.
What is it about making mistakes that is so tilting for you? Is it that they're obvious? Do you feel like you shouldn't make them because you know better? Like, what is it that tilts you about it?
Just the fact that I know before I do it that is wrong.
Okay.
Then I don't know. Other than that, I think that sometimes I just get frustrated because I feel as if, you know, my head's just a muddle. And, you know, when everything's going great, you like process all the information and make the best decisions. And then when things start to go badly, start to feel as if you miss things that you wouldn't normally do, or you're not thinking as clear. Yeah. And that just starts to get really frustrated when I just can't think clearly.
And let me ask this, do you realize that the reason that you think you can't think clearly at that point is because of the emotion?
I mean, yeah, I would agree that that's definitely why it's there.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, the reality is when your emotions get overactive, they actually shut down your ability to think clearly. So it's not like this is some fault of your own. This is just a factual reality of how the brain operates. So what this does is it says that there is an absolute premium for you to be able to prevent your emotions from getting to that point. Now, being on a bad run, I'm not saying that that's easy, but being able to prepare yourself as best you can to fight as long as you can to maintain, you know, a solid game, is at a very, very, there's a premium for that. So if you get to the point where you find that you can't recover that ability, for right now, it's important that you quit. So you fight for as long as you can to push yourself to play as well as you can for as long as you can, and avoid making these mistakes. But when you can't recover that, you've got to take a break. Even if it's for just a half hour or an hour until you can get your mind to mentally recover enough, you're essentially, it's like poker suicide. I mean, you're setting yourself up to fail.
Sure.
Okay. So, but as we kind of look back at like the frustration that comes with making these mistakes, like, you know before you do it that it's wrong, but I wonder how little you might be motivated to do what's right because you're looking for God mode for it to turn around. So you might be willing to gamble more. You might be willing to take a lot higher variance spot, a lot more higher variance in spots that you wouldn't normally, because you're looking to get the luck to break the cycle.
Oh yeah, definitely. Like,
okay.
Yeah. So go ahead.
No, I was just gonna say that you can see how you have two conflicting motivations: God mode to save you, good play to sort of meander along and steadily work your way back up. It's like, which one's it going to be? Because you can't have both.
Sure, yeah.
I mean, that's a question you've got to answer yourself. I mean, I would like to know the answer. You know, it's that you want to, you know, work harder to play better and realize that, you know, God mode is not going to save you.
Yeah. I mean, I would prefer the God mode just because it would be quicker, but I realize that good play is a better long-term strategy.
God mode will save you, but going after God mode now will kill you long-term.
Sure, yeah.
That's one of those things where, you know, be careful what you wish for. If you actually got it...
it may not be a good thing.
No, because what are you learning? If you get it, what do you learn? You learn, it doesn't matter how badly I play. eventually something will save me.
Yeah, that's true.
Something beyond your control. You know, which puts you in a very risky position, which puts you in a risky position for reasons that have killed a lot of poker players. You know, they stop working. You know, they don't continue to improve when, you know, they've been saved by variance in the past. So I think you've got to kill your wish. You've got to realize that, you know, it could actually, chasing this could be your demise. And being able to work hard. And I've given some advice through this show today that I think would be really helpful for you to listen to after we get it turned into a podcast, that will really help you to organize your learning so that you can be prepared every single time you play to make sure that you're not just there to correct these specific mistakes, but you're also there to correct the mistake that is the desire to want God mode to save you. So you're instead saying, no, this is on me. I'm going to work myself through it. And if you do that, then you earn a skill, like the skill of resilience, the skill of being able to work through hard times and rebuild your game to be even stronger than it was prior to the downswing. That is a skill that will carry you forward, because you're going to have another downswing at some point. And if you are able to come out stronger through that next downswing, you know, then your game is going to be in position to capitalize on whatever happens, both after this one, after future ones. And ultimately, that's going to be, you know, a much more wiser, longer-term strategy for how you approach the game.
Yeah, definitely.
Okay. Does that help?
Yeah, that's yeah, definitely. It's a good frame of mind to be in, I think.
Okay, beautiful. All right, Tom. Well, thanks for coming on, man. You know, I'm on Twitter if you want to follow up, and maybe we'll have you back on down the road to see how your progress goes.
Cool. That'd be excellent. Cheers.
Yeah. All right. You're welcome. Bye-bye.
See it.
All right. Well, this kind of wraps up another episode of the Mental Game Radio Show. I want to thank my guests for coming on today. A little bit random. Worked our way through it, and hopefully it was a pretty powerful show for many of you. I mean, we talked about some things that I think would be very, very helpful for many of you as far as your learning, and certainly the bits about overconfidence mentioned earlier in the show. I also want to just remind those of you who are members of Black Belt Poker, you can get my book in their loyalty store. Or for those of you who are not members, books available on Amazon.com, TheMentalGameOfPoker.com. And if you're interested in the blog post that I wrote about overconfidence being a silent killer, JaredTendlerPoker.com. You can follow me on Twitter, at JaredTendler. And up next, cash plays coming to QuadJacks. With my buddies from Stack'em Coaching, Joe Tehan and John Kim. Should be a great show. Hope all of you enjoy it. And until next week, have a great week, and I'll see you on the Mental Game Radio Show next week. Be well, everyone.
You're traveling through another dimension. A dimension not only of luck and skill, but of mind. You're navigating on a river of tilt in an underworld of variance and risk. You've just crossed over into the mental.